My God. 1 Corinthians 11:23, we're going to do our communion supper. Remember, it's dinner. And in light of what we're studying in Hebrews, I'm hoping that as we take communion, that you're seeing. I need you to see this, okay? The Bible is not a bunch of separate incidences. They're really tied together. They're trying to get you to see the all-encompassing that's what he said.
Truth of the Lord Jesus Christ mm-hmm. and his gospel. Good news is what gospel.
Jesus gave himself. He gave them a dinner so that they wouldn't forget what he gave, why he gave it, how it puts you in connection with God. The sacrifice of the body and the blood gives you a right to enter into the holies of holies of God, where one time a year only one guy could do it. And now, because of the blood of Jesus, because of the breaking of his body, everybody who names that name has the right to approach an eternal God in the spirit. You have the right. He looks at you as he looks at Jesus.
Righteous, holy, set apart, and one with himself.
Like I said, if you gotta meditate on Hebrews 10:18, do so. Cause you gotta renew your mind if you're gonna walk in the power of God. You can only walk in the power of God if you know you are forgiven. These are the rules, people. I didn't make them up. They just are the rules. God says, this is what I've done. I need you to believe that. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
All right. 1 Corinthians 11:23. Thank you. This is Paul writing to the Corinthians, our dear brethren. And I look forward to meeting the Corinthians someday. And hear some of their stories. Wild child. For I received from the Lord himself, this is Paul, that instruction which I passed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, be a thankful believer. Be thankful. Thanksgiving is not a day on the calendar. It is the way believers live.
Yeah.
Okay? And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this represents my body, which is offered as a sacrifice for you. Ladies and gentlemen, the best gift Jesus ever gave was himself.
Yeah.
I'm going to just be honest with y'all. I don't love none of y'all enough to give myself. I'm just going to put it out there. But God gave himself because of his great love for the Father and the Father's creation to pay the price so that we could be bought back, redeemed into our place of honor. Hallelujah.
We have redemption.
We have redemption.
The forgiveness of sins in the kingdom of God through the new covenant,
mm-hmm.
the Lord Jesus.
Amen. Amen. Do this in affectionate remembrance of me. Father, we thank you for being broken. And we take all that brokenness has brought for us, Father, because of your goodness. Amen. Eat. Hallelujah. In the same way, after supper, thank you, he took the cup, saying, this cup, or in this cup, is the new covenant ratified and established in my blood. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Some people say, well, that's such a bloody religion. But yes, thank you. It is. Because without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. I needed my sin taken completely away from me. And it took the blood of a sinless lamb for it to happen. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your blood so that we can be made righteous with God and have fellowship with him. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you for the blood.
Yeah, that's God's economy there. In terms of the fact that he is holy and death is a result of sin. And blood must be shed as a result. So the blood of Jesus is incorruptible blood. Mm-hmm. And the blood of bulls and goats is corruptible. So therefore, the blood of Jesus inaugurates a new covenant.
Do this as often as you drink it in affectionate remembrance of me, for every time you eat in remembrance of me. Partake.
Thank you.
Ooh. Grapefruit juice. Why you keep? Ooh. Ooh. I don't ever know what kind of juice he's going to bring me. He doesn't tell me. And so I partake, like I tell y'all, and sometimes it's grapefruit juice. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are symbolically proclaiming the fact of the Lord's death until he comes again.
Yeah,
he's coming again. He's coming again, and part of his coming again is to be ready.
Be ready for the return of the Lord. Yeah.
To be anticipating his return. You know, my class of graduation from high school was 76. And we just had one of the young ladies from my class who has just passed. And here's the reality. If you know Jesus, you're going to meet him at your leaving or his return. You will meet him. You will meet him. If you've received him as your Lord and Savior, at your death, you go to be with him. If you are alive when he returns, you get to meet him when he returns. You're not gonna leave this earth without having met Jesus, okay? you get to meet him. But our job is to be prepared for his return, whether it's in our death or his return. You don't get to take a vacation. Well, I'm just tired of waiting on Jesus. I'm just throwing this all away. I don't have nothing else to do with this thing. I wouldn't do that if I was you. You are a living example of the goodness of God. If you would sit down and look at the miracles that have already happened in your life, you would see that Jesus has been watching over you, looking over you, protecting you, as my mom said, from dangers seen and unseen. Don't let your frustration put you in a position where you throw away the only great and wonderful thing is probably the greatest thing that's ever happened in any of our lives. Being born again by the Spirit of the living God. You, my brother, my sister, young man, young lady, boy, girl, you are purposed by the Almighty God. You were born for such a time as now, and God is not willing to do without you. So be encouraged, stay encouraged, encourage one another, so that the power of God can stay moving through his body on the earth, just like it worked in him when he was here. Be faithful to God. He is faithful to you. Always has been and always will be.